So let us continue with our I/O versus memory bus. Let me change the cursor here. First, click on the time cursor whenever I am, moving from the slideshow. Then I have to pick this. Anyway, there's I/O versus memory bus back here. So in this, in addition to communicating with I/O, the processor must communicate with the memory unit also. That's what I was before Anderson had come here. I was talking about this. In addition to this processor talking to this I/O, communicating to this I/O devices through this I/O bus, it should be able to communicate with the memory also here. For that reason, so what is that we call something called memory bus? The processor must communicate with the memory unit, like the I/O bus. The memory bus contains data, address, and read-write control lines. You see here. In this I/O, you see carefully here, this I/O bus, what we see here, one is data line we see, the other is address line we see, the other is control line we see. So yesterday we spoke a lot about this data line, address line, control line, but while we talk about the memory here, memory bus here, we will be having the same data, because processor will be sending why memory is required to write some data and to read some data from that. So one data bus is required, and then memory will have some locations. So what is required? Address is also required. So that is address bus. And what control signals are required from the memory? We may read from the memory or we may write to the memory. So for that, read write control signals are required. So that's the reason why here you see we have here, apart from having this data, apart from having this address, we have read-write control lines, all right? So there are three ways that computer buses can be used to communicate with memory and I/O. We are talking about now buses, meaning we included in that I/O and memory bus, both we included here. Remember this, no confusion here. There are three ways that computer means again, and this processor should be able to communicate with this I/O bus, also should be able to communicate with the memory bus. How is that it is going to do that? How is that it is going to handle that? So in three ways it is going to handle. First is, carefully listen, examination point of view important, use two separate buses. We have to use two separate buses, one for memory and the other for I/O. Two separate buses, separate them, just simply separate them. One for memory, the other for I/O. The other is, use one common bus. Let there be only one common bus, which is connecting your I/O devices, and also it is connecting your memory device. So one common bus for both memory and I/O. But have separate control lines for each. Separate control lines, remember. So it's, I go back again here to this one. This is same. Again, the same bus may be here going for the memory, that is the data line and the same address line. But use this separate control lines for them separately. You take control lines. So that is separate. We have to do in the second case. Use one common bus for both memory and I/O, but have separate control lines for each. The third method is, use one common bus for memory and I/O. Here also in the second also same, use one common bus for both memory and I/O. Here we are going to have separate control lines, but here we are going to have with the common control lines. This is the third. So how is that really going to happen and all? In subsequent slides we will see. So, but remember at this stage, there are three ways to communicate to the I/O devices and the memory. These three ways are listed here. To use two separate buses, one for memory, the other for I/O. Meaning here totally data line is different, address line is different, control line is different for memory. Here data line is different and the control line is different, address line is different for the I/O devices. But here only one common bus, meaning for data, for address the same, only we are separating the control lines. In this case, all are set. So In the first method, this is how we achieve this first method. In the first method, the computer has independent sets of data, address and control buses, one for accessing memory and the other for accessing I/O. This is done in computers that provide a separate I/O processor in addition to the central processing unit. The meaning here, apart from having this processor, we will be having one IOP here. So this is this processor, input-output processor, its job is to handle separate buses for this memory, for this I/O. Who is handling that? The processor now. Processor will instruct the IOP processor whether it wants to communicate to the I/O devices or whether it wants to communicate to the memory devices. So who is going to facilitate that service? This IOP is going to facilitate that service to be able to communicate to the I/O devices or memory devices. That processor is requested. So who is doing that? IOP is doing that. In the first case, remember, that is the first case where we are this one. One for accessing memory and the other for I/O. This is done in computers that provide a separate I/O processor in addition to the central processing unit. The memory communicates with both a CPU and the IOP through a memory bus. The same here orally so far, what I was talking about going to that figure, so the same is written down here. So the IOP communicates with the input and output devices through a separate I/O bus with its own address, data and control line. That is very obvious. IOP should have separate data, separate address, separate control line, so that this IOP input-output processor can communicate to the I/O devices. The purpose of the IOP is to provide an independent pathway for the transfer of information between external devices and internal memory. The I/O processor, input-output processor, IOP nothing but input-output processor, is sometimes called data channel. So 1, 2, 3, 4. These are the four points that you have to remember in the first case. This use two separate buses, one for memory and other for I/O. How is that possible? With the help of IOP, it is. What IOP is doing here, it is facilitating separate path lines for the completely to access this I/O devices, a separate address, data and control. Similarly, a separate bus for the memory also. So CPU is asking the IOP to facilitate the communication between memory or the I/O bus, memory bus or the I/O bus. So that is what all about this. So let us go to this next second method and the third method. In the second method, we are calling it as an isolated. Third method, we are calling it as a memory mapped I/O. Remember, very, very important idea, and I'm stressing this point. Here, if you go here, why we are calling isolated method? Because if you see here, we are separating here, separate control lines. Separate control lines meaning isolating. We are isolating the control line. That's why separate. Here we are using the common control lines. So these common control lines are termed as memory mapped I/O. So second method is the isolated method, isolated I/O method. Third method is memory mapped I/O, wherein we are using common control lines. Here we are using separate control lines. Now, coming to this, many computers use one common bus to transfer information between memory or I/O and the CPU. From memory to CPU or from I/O to CPU, they use majority of the computers, many computers, most of the computers will use one common bus. The distinction between memory transfer and I/O transferring is made through separate read. Then how is that possible that this processor able to distinguish what it is sending, suppose it is sending a data for a printer. So how is that the data being sent by the processor is really going to the printer? So that is what this point is talking about. The distinction between a memory transfer and I/O transfer distinction, this distinction is made through separate read and write lines. The CPU specifies whether the address on the address lines is for memory word or for an interface register by enabling one of the two possible read or write lines. The I/O read and I/O write control lines are enabled during I/O transfer. For if at all processor is really want to communicate with the I/O device, then I/O input output read and input output write control signal will be enabled. If it is second point, look at the second. The memory read and memory write control lines are enabled during memory transfer. So here, please understand this. There shouldn't be any confusion here. We are isolating control signals. Is that clear? Point number one. So how do we separate the control lines with the help of this I/O read? There is a signal, control signal. I/O write, there is another control signal. If these control signals are coming out of the processor, then it is understood that the information, that address, that data going through earlier we have shown here this data, this address is actually meant for I/O devices. Why? The reason is this control, what is coming out the control? Control is coming out I/O read or I/O write. So for that purpose, it is very much understood by this interface modules that, oh, this control signal is for me because it's the I/O read or I/O write. It's not a memory read or memory write. If that is the case, then it is going here, the other side for the memory. So the second one, if you see here, the memory read and the memory write control lines are enabled during memory transfer. So we are simply playing with the control lines here. If we want to transfer anything to the I/O, we are enabling I/O read and I/O write control lines. If we want to send anything to the memory, then we are simply enabling, depending upon the read or write, memory read or memory write. So with this mechanism, but having a separate control signals, we are able to handle with the using the common bus, but two separate control lines. Is that clear to everyone? I am just pausing here because it needs to be cleared here. Without this clearance, again, you'll mess up. Is that clear to everyone? If someone having a doubt, you can ask about that concept, like a common bus, two separate control lines. And we also call that mechanism as an isolated mechanism. So if you don't have any doubts, again, I request here, in a chat window, you please type no. If you have doubt, then you please unmute yourself and talk to me. Somebody typed Muhammad Arbaaz, sir, voice is breaking in between. Muhammad Arbaaz, can you unmute yourself? Am I clear to you? Muhammad Arbaaz, help me out by unmuting yourself and talking to me. Muhammad Arbaaz, on the screen you see mic, you simply have to touch that, across should go. So at that time you can talk to me, Muhammad Arbaaz. Am I audible to you, Muhammad Arbaaz? I don't know, Muhammad Arbaaz, whether able to get my voice or not. He's not chatting also. He's not doing Muhammad Arbaaz. Yes, he did. Thank you, Arbaaz. Others, I guess you don't have any doubt, I think.
Sir, I/O read means what actually it is, sir?
I/O?
Read.
Okay, it's nothing. This is simply just a signal. You have mux, right? For example, you have 2:1 or 2:1 mux, suppose, okay? you keep communicating to me, Arbaaz. Yeah, Arbaaz.
Yes, sir.
In that MUX, the select line is there, select line.
Yes, sir.
So that select line is nothing but a control line. Let us say that select line is a control line. Okay.
Okay, sir.
So select line when 0, then line A is selected. Or if you are using 2 by 1 MUX or 2:1 MUX, if select line is a 0, A line is kept on the output Y.
Yes, sir.
If select line is 1, then B line is kept on Y.
Yes, sir.
So meaning the select line is actually working like a control line. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Likewise. We if you go here, that is, let me go again here, that is this figure. You see this figure, the one who is talking, Arbaaz, I guess.
Yes, sir. No, sir. Salman, sir. Yes.
Salman. Salman, here you see these lines here.
Yes, sir.
So these on these lines, this processor actually putting some signal here, like a select line, like select on a MUX example I took. Yes. Yeah, select line, yes. Are you getting?
Yes, sir.
Likewise, it is just putting some signal here. So if it is actually intending to communicate to the I/O devices, it is putting here a signal. We are, for our purpose, we are calling it as a I/O read, that is input output read, the way select line is there, like that I/O read. So something if you want to take from the keyboard, you want to read from the keyboard, so I/O read. Okay.
Okay, sir.
So suppose a processor wants to write some data onto the magnetic disk, it is I/O write, input output
Right.
write.